Hi, everyone. Welcome to this round of the Edward Jones Chatting Cage. You can see him in the window next to me. It's two of the great minds in baseball from MLB Pipeline and the big draft on the horizon. Jim Callis and Jonathan Mayo join us for a very special draft day. Chatting Cage, gentlemen, how are you doing? I know this is an exhausting time of year for you. Can you answer some questions from some fans?
No, I can't speak for Jim. Jim's just a hologram right now, so sure. We'll do the best we can.
No, we're good. I actually feel like we're fairly well rested for this stage of the
considering,
draft.
Considering, yeah. We're ready to go.
All right, well, let's take all the wind out of your sails then. Fans, get fired up. Don't make me do all the work. Get your device fired up. Ask these guys questions directly. Meanwhile, use the MLB Fans app or Twitter, hashtag Chatting Cage, and I'll read that in my best reading voice. I go to the MLB Fans app right now, and I like this one from Scout Ekholm. Gentlemen, who's the most interesting player in the draft this year? Interesting player in the draft this year.
I don't know what interesting means exactly.
Exactly.
Oh, you know what else I'll say? I'll steal your guy probably. But, I mean, Hunter Green, I mean, is interesting because he's a talented two-way player. Could be a first-round pick as a pitcher, as a hitter. You've done a series of stories. He's a real interesting kid off the field. He's got a lot of personality.
Throws 100 miles an hour. That's a good one. I mean, Brendan McKay is a guy who would be a top-five pick as a hitter or a pitcher. You know, we haven't seen that at all, bar your line, since Dave Winfield. Those two guys have a chance to go 1 and 2 in the draft. So we're talking guys at the top who have sort of some interesting wrinkles in terms of what they can do.
I'd say that's absolutely interesting. There you have it. You start talking about Dave Winfield in a sentence with somebody. That's certainly getting fascinating. So this is our Edward Jones Chatting Cage. That's Jim Callis and Jonathan Mayo. Fielding your questions, a fan joins us on the road. Excellent. Drive safely, sir. What's your name? What's your question for the guys?
I'm pulled over. Don't worry.
All right. Thank you.
I was just wondering, we've all wanted to know for about a month now, will Hunter Green play for the Twins as of tonight?
All right.
No. He will not.
Well, no. Even if he gets drafted number one, he won't play for the Twins tonight. No. Go ahead.
I think it's come down to two guys for the Twins. I think it's all likelihood going to be Brendan McKay, who we just talked about, the two-way star from Louisville. I think they prefer him as a pitcher and will let him play both ways, at least at the start of his career. And I think the backup plan would be Royce Lewis, the California high school shortstop outfielder. But I think it's McKay, unless Royce Lewis would cut a deal that was significantly cheaper enough than what it would cost to sign McKay. So I think it's one of the two. I don't think they're on Green. I think Cincinnati Reds fans will be welcoming Hunter Green to the fold this evening.
I agree.
All right, there we have it. And Jim Callis sticking by his commitment to answer yes or no to each question. We appreciate that. This is the Edward Jones Chatting Cage. I go back to the MLB Fans app. By the way, if you are mobile and driving, pull over like that gentleman did before you ask a question. That's an important part of this thing. Or be a passenger. From Red Bostonian, Jim, Jonathan, what do you enjoy the most about the MLB draft?
Jim's company.
You have that all year, let's be honest.
Yeah, but it's like really heightened right now. Trust me. I'm ready for a little break, I think. Now, it always gets a little crazy as we lead up to it, and there is fatigue that sets in. But, I mean, for me, more than anything, I like introducing a new wave of potential MLB stars to baseball fans at large. I know we both take that job very seriously. We try to put a lot of good information out there. We try to project the first round the right way. But for us to be conduits into letting people know who these guys are and what you can expect from them, to me, that's what I like the most.
Yeah, I like that too. And I think the most fun part for me is the logic puzzle that is putting together first round projections where you're like, okay, if this guy goes here, the domino effect and how it can unfold. And I also, I feel like it's a time of year, Jonathan, where by nature of our jobs, we're constantly asking people, how good is this player? How good is that player? Those types of questions. This is a time of year we can actually, it's like a two-way street of information where we have teams, we have agents asking us what we're hearing, where do you think this guy's going to go? So it's a time of year where we can actually help people in addition to having them help us rather than just, hey, tell me about this guy, this guy, this guy. It's a give and take. So I enjoy, and when we're done here with this and a couple other things, we're going to try to do one more mock draft for the website this evening. But I love trying to figure out where all the pieces are going to fall.
And I'll just piggyback on that. Talking to people in the scouting industry, scouting directors, cross-checkers, it's actually one of the most fun parts of our job because those are the guys who are out going and seeing all these players. And, you know, we do lean on them heavily, and it is nice that we can kind of return the favor as we get close. But, you know, these guys are the backbones of baseball. Without scouts who traverse the country to see all these players, none of these players become professionals.
Thank you for that, guys. Great insight into what this time of year is like for you and what the draft is enjoyable about. That's Jim Callis, Jonathan Mayo taking your question, folks. The hashtag is ChattingCage on Twitter, or use the MLB Fans app and join us via your device, like this fan. What's your name? What's your question for Jim and Jonathan?
My name is Brian. I was wondering, is there any truth to the rumor that the Padres are going to take Helio Ramos with the third overall pick?
I don't think there's truth to that. I mean, two teams that get associated with virtually every player in this draft are the Padres and the Braves.
Right.
You feel like you hear every player that the Braves are going to take at number five, and almost every player you hear the Padres are hoping to cut a deal with their second pick. They're going to hope the guy falls down to their second pick. I don't doubt that the Padres have interest in Ramos. A lot of teams do. We're hearing that he may not even last 20 picks. I don't think he's going to get back to them. I feel like the Padres, I keep hearing this, unless Hunter Green is there, which I don't think is going to happen because I think that's the Reds guy 100% at two, I think the Padres are taking Mackenzie Gore. And then I think the Padres would love to see Helio Ramos when they pick again 30 picks or so later, but that's not going to happen because there's too many teams interested in it.
Yeah, maybe they'll make an attempt to push them down to them in their second pick. They've been known to do that. Last year the word was that they were trying to do that with Jay Groom, the left-handed pitcher, who was at the top of our top 200, and the Red Sox swooped in and took him before they got the chance. And I think I could see, you know, something like that with Ramos, where there are enough teams that are interested in him before the Padres pick again, but I don't think there's any chance he goes number three.
All right, there. Thanks, fan, for joining us and getting that question out there. We appreciate the guys answering that. I go to Twitter now. The hashtag is ChattingCage, Jonathan Mayo, Jim Callis. Are there any draft surprises you guys already envision or are predicting? Is there something against the grain that you see happening?
I mean, I guess the one that started coming up yesterday, you know, is the where the Atlanta Braves are looking at number five. And, you know, we both in the mock draft that's up right now went with Keston Hiura, who's a very talented hitter. A lot of people think maybe the best college bat in the class, but was not a guy that people really thought of as a top five pick. The Braves have been known to cut a deal. They did it with Ian Anderson at number three a year ago, and then aggressively go after some high ceiling talent with some of their additional picks, you know, later on in the draft. And we've heard a whole bunch of names with the Braves at number five, and Hiura is the one we both went with. So that would be the first thing that came to my mind up top in terms of where things could really change.
Yeah, and it's not to sound arrogant about it, but we talked to so many people. It's like if Hiura does go five today, it's not going to be a surprise because we've been hearing that for a day.
Right.
I mean, I guess the latest name I heard in the first round last night that I had not heard to that point as a potential first rounder was Drew Rasmussen from Oregon State, who's come back from Tommy John and is throwing the ball very well for the Beavers, who I believe are now 54-4 and headed to Omaha. But, you know, I mean, the surprise will be, and there's no way to know this in advance, is there will be some deals cut, some discount guys taken for under slots, teams can spend more later, and the teams generally keep those under wraps. So you may see the Rays at four or Team X wherever take a guy at 11
right,
who we weren't expecting. But that stuff's, we try to ferret that out, but usually you find that out when they get picked.
Great. Thank you so much for that, guys. Those are the things to look forward to. Atlanta number five actually was a big question from a lot of fans out there in the social media space and in the live space. So thank you for answering for that. Another fan joins us in the cage. What's your name? What is your question?
Hi, I'm Mark. I just want to know where you guys think Jordan Adele could end up in the draft.
Well, I think the first landing spot for him is probably 9 to Milwaukee. I haven't heard him higher than that. Have you?
No, I mean,
not really.
Unless somebody tries to do a deal that
right,
we don't see coming. But yeah, I think 9's probably the highest spot. It's, I hear him, you know, it's funny. We've been writing for a while, at least I've been writing for a while. I think you probably have too, that he could go in the top 10 or he might all go all the way in the 20s. I've heard enough teams that seem to be on him in the teens. I think he's going to go somewhere in that 13 to 16 range, maybe. You know, you got the Marlins at 13, you have the Yankees at 16, Astros at 15, Royals at 14. Kind of feel like that's his sweet spot. Maybe he gets a little past that, but not far.
Right. Yeah, he's got tremendous tools. There are some scouts a little concerned with the swing and miss, but I think the upside is considerable. If it weren't for the swing and miss, we would be talking about him at the very top of the draft. I mean, that's how high his ceiling is if he can refine his approach at the plate and make more consistent contact.
Thank you, fan. Thank you, guys. As we continue to roll along in this Edward Jones Chatting Cage Draft Day Special Edition, it's time now for the EDJ Question of the Day. Gents, we touched on it a little bit earlier about the overall, about the draft itself, about what you liked about it. So most specifically, though, if you can build on that, how much fun is this time of year for you two?
Oh, it's great. I mean, I think this is my favorite time of year, baseball.
Sure.
Plus. You know, it's I mean, this analogy gets used all the time, but it really is, you know, like the equivalent of Christmas or Hanukkah for
Thank you, Jonathan.
But no, it's like you have all the, it's like the night before the draft is kind of, you have all the presents wrapped under the tree, and then we wait, and then we get to open them and see who, which team gets which guy. But no, it's like I said, it's kind of fun trying to figure out who's going where, as Jonathan alluded to. You know, these are going to be, there are going to be some great stars who come out of this draft. Mm-hmm. You know, we aren't going to necessarily know who they are right away, but we'll look back like we did the first draft that they ever had here at MLB Network. One player was here, Mike Trout. You know, he's pretty good.
Yeah, that worked out
well. That was kind of a pretty neat deal. So this is the most fun time of year, I think.
Yeah, and I like that analogy much better than the one when people ask me, well, how busy are you? I'm like, well, it's kind of like an accountant on tax day. That does not sound like fun. That is how busy we are, but we enjoy it, as I would imagine CPAs across this land enjoy tax day.
Just the answer I thought we'd get for the EDJ question of the day from Jim and Jonathan.
Yeah, you can clip that and put it in a quote box somewhere.
Posterity will have that forever. Another fan joins us here in the cage on the move. What's your name? What's your question for Jim?
Sal, and my question is, I'm a Cleveland Indians fan, and that's 64th pick. Who are some sleepers that can go that will be effective in the league in the second round?
Jonathan, you projected the first two rounds in your mock draft.
I did. Was that 64? Is that an Indians fan?
I couldn't quite hear everything. Yes. That was Indians.
You know, I would love to be able to pull a name out for you right now, but the one thing that limits you when you pick that late is you don't have as much money to work with. So there will be some interesting names that don't go that we thought could go early but have slid because of signability, and the chances of the Indians being able to be aggressive and go after that player are limited somewhat because of the amount of money they had to spend. That said, I mean, I'm trying to rack my brain.
I'm going to throw two darts at the board here.
Please.
Only because I got asked this question on Twitter. James Marinen, a high school right-hander from Florida, I think the Indians like a little bit. We have him ranked kind of right around there on our top 200. And I do think, I mean, the Indians do draft a lot of college players. It's possible. Like, we have a kind of a sweet spot of college performers right around there who probably will go ahead of that, but I'll throw Greg Dykeman of LSU out there. So if it's right, I'm going to point to this video and say I called pick 64, but those are just basic wild guesses.
Yep.
That's a good cluster of names, though. I like that. Well done, guys, answering the Cleveland fan as he walks around giving you the questions. This is the Edward Jones Chatting Cage, Draft Day Edition. I go back to the MLB Fans app. Justin Gray wants to know, and I'm going to paraphrase a little bit, who's the best home run hitter in this draft? So who's the best power guy in this draft, guys?
Well, it's got to be Jake Berger, right?
Yeah, I think Jake Berger's got the most usable power. He's got the track record. He's done it in college. I mean, if you talk about, you know, upside, you know, we mentioned Joe Adele. I mean, Joe Adele led the, for what it's worth, it's high school stats, but he led the nation with 24 or 25 home runs in Kentucky. I mean, he can crush balls a long way. Hunter Green, who's going to get drafted as a pitcher,
he's got
some balls,
tremendous raw power,
you know, opposite field, you know, in the stands at Target Field the other day in a workout. So a lot of good power. But if we're looking at usable power, who's going to hit the most home runs in the big leagues? I think Jake Berger is probably the best bet.
Thank you for that. I'll go back to the MLB Fans app. This one a little less draft specific. SanFran92 wants to know, Jim, Jonathan, what do you guys love about the sport of baseball?
Wow. Well, I mean, I played it as a kid. You know, I'm sure we both did. I've always loved it. You know, for me, baseball is sort of been an heirloom that's been passed down from generation to generation. And my mom actually, in some ways, was a bigger baseball fan than my dad, although he was as well. She was an only child, and her dad was forward-thinking enough to teach her the game, and then it was passed down to me, and passing it down to my kids. And you know, I love the history of it and the forward thinking part of it that we do, and you know, sort of bringing that all together.
Yeah, I mean, I enjoy the sport. I mean, there's so much strategy you can dissect when you're watching a game. There's both a lot going on, but also kind of the pace. There's some lulls in the action, so it's not like you have to be riveted for 3 hours watching every second. You can have a nice conversation while you're watching a baseball game. You know, and like Jonathan said, I just enjoy covering it too, trying to figure out. I mean, we're kind of in the prognostication business, identifying, you know, who are the stars of tomorrow. That's always fascinated me. From when I was a kid, I wanted to know who they were, and now I try to tell people who they're going to be. No.
Well, that's great. Thank you both for sharing that. That's great to see why you guys love it and why you're so good at it, because it takes a lot of passion to stay tuned and tapped in like you are. Tradition and prognostication, two great reasons to love the sport of baseball. Another fan joins us in the cage. What's your name? What's your question?
Ephraim from Teaneck. My question is, if you guys are sitting in Sandy Alderson's position in New York for the Mets at number 20, who would you guys pick for the Mets?
I'm now trying to remember who it is I did put there. Well, one name that did come up is Nate Pearson, who's a junior college right-hander who kind of made some headlines a couple weeks ago through a bullpen session for a lot of scouts and was consistently throwing in triple digits. I know it sounds surprising that the Mets would be interested in a power arm, but he's kind of jumped into the conversation right around there. I think Nick Prado, if you want to go high school bat, is a name that if he's there around 20, is a guy that they would consider as a high school first baseman from Southern California with some power potential and glove, gold glove caliber defense at first.
I think they'd like to see Evan White from Kentucky, the really athletic first baseman, who I think has some untapped power, get to them. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that he necessarily will. I think he might go a little bit before that. David Peterson from Oregon, who's a polished college left-hander, who's had a very nice year. He'd be interesting. He's going to be right around that range. It's, you know, the in terms of who you'd like to see, the tough part for us and really tough part for the Mets is, like, you just don't know. When you're picking 20, you have your list. They're probably going to get a guy who's, like, 12th on their list. They just don't, you know, or 13 or 14. They're going to get a guy who's up six or seven spots on their list. They just don't know who it'll be. So you have to kind of wait and play it out. But those are some candidates for him there at 20.
Thank you for that question, obviously, from a Mets fan. Wonder what Sandy might do. You both had Nate Pearson listed on this morning's mock, by the way, just so you know.
We actually do our mocks totally separately, but yet we seem to arrive at the same conclusions a lot.
It's pretty remarkable. It's like you guys know the business. Another fan joined us in the cage. What's your name? What's your question?
Hello, my name is Scout, and my question is, does the prospect's attitude affect how high he'll be drafted?
Interesting.
Prospect attitude, yes. I mean, it does to an extent. And it's called any of a number of things, character, makeup, you name it. But obviously, you know, if a player has that sort of that plus attitude, you know, they're a gamer, off the field, they're mature, you know, they're good leaders, that's always going to help because that helps you. It's a risky business to draft, you know, and there is a certain semblance of crapshoot nature to it. So if there are those kinds of qualities in a player that you think are going to help them maximize the natural ability they have, then, yeah, I think that definitely helps.
Yeah, I mean, I almost think teams, I don't know if they spend more time on it, but they spend probably more time on it than average fan thinks, trying to figure out a player's makeup. I mean, the physical tools, yeah, there's going to be some range of opinions on how good a player's fastball is or is bad or whatever, but it's going to be pretty close range of opinions. I mean, if a guy's throwing 96, most people are going to say, I like that fastball. Right. But you have to know, you know, like Jonathan said, work ethic, you know, how the guy's going to handle adversity, what kind of character it is. Teams spend an awful lot of time trying to get to know the players, especially in the draft, before they pick them for just that reason. You don't want to take a guy and then find out he's got some flaw in his makeup. Maybe he doesn't work hard or whatever, has some kind of problem you didn't realize. You don't want to find that out after you've signed the guy. You need to know that beforehand.
All right, Jim, Jonathan, as always, amazing to talk to you, get your insights on a day like this. Did you have fun? I know you got a lot going on today. Did you enjoy taking some time out answering fans directly today?
I love the chatting cage, you know, and it's always fun to be able to answer people's questions.
It's great. You guys are unbelievable information, a font of information, a wealth of information. We appreciate you sharing it with us. Have a great day. Enjoy tonight as round one gets underway in the next couple days of coverage. I know we'll see you over here on this side of the river after today. Thanks for being with us. And fans, as always, thank you for making this thing work. Without you, it's just me yelling at people. Nobody really wants to watch that. So we'll see you on the next round of the Edward Jones Chatting Cage. Mm-hmm.